Okay, I think it is time to introduce the last but not least speaker of today's late afternoon session. And this is Ivan Dinikov from Steklov Mathematical Institute of the Russian Academy of Sciences. And his topic is on an algorithm to distinguish Legendre knots.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation, and I want to apologize for not coming on the time my talk was originally scheduled. This is due to my disorientation after a long trip the previous night, and due to the fact that I'm now organizing another conference. So I'm sorry. Okay, this talk is summarizes several results which I obtained in collaboration with Maxim Praslov and Vladimir Shastin. And one final ingredient of this talk is not yet prepared for publication, but it's already we are just writing it down. Okay, I will speak about Legendre knots, which are of interest in contact topology. So let me recall some standard definitions. I will consider only the standard contact structure in the three-dimensional space and also its mirror image. The contact structure is a plane distribution which is nowhere integrable. It means that it fails to satisfy integrability condition at any point. So, and the standard contact structure is just the plane distribution defined by this one form. If a smooth curve is tangent to the everywhere to this plane distribution, it is called Legendrian. And one of the objects of interest in contact topology are so-called Legendrian knots, Legendrian in this sense. And Legendre knots are considered, are viewed up to equivalence, which is now an isotopy, which is now understood as isotopy within the class of Legendre knots. So it can easily happen that two Legendre knots are topologically equivalent, but they are not equivalent as Legendre knots. So every topological class is subdivided into infinitely many equivalence classes of Legendre knots. In order to deal with Legendre knots, of course, we need some way to represent them. And one of the most common representations of Legendre knots is a front projection. Front projection is just the projection to the plane along YZ plane along the X axis. So since our curve is tangent to the plane distribution defined by the form x dy plus dz, one can see that such projection is never regular because the y coordinate cannot have at all points where y coordinate is has maximal minima, at all such points the curve must have a cusp like this. Okay. But this is the only essential feature of a plane projection. Another point is that at every crossing, there is actually no need to specify which branch is overcrossing and which branch is undercrossing, because this can be deduced from the knowledge of the slope. The greater the slope, the smaller is the x coordinate along which we project. So at every crossing, the branch which has smaller slope is overcrossing. But so it's not necessary to specify at every crossing, yes, because this can be recovered from the projection itself. But to have it more visual, we always draw it like this. Just to have a conventional picture of this knot. Okay, there is a theorem which was written down by Svitkovsky that two front projections of Legendrian knots define equivalently Legendrian knots if and only if one can obtain one from the other by a sequence of moves, which are similar to already master moves, but now they are of course modified so that cusps are involved in some moves. For instance, the first with the master move is modified so that we create not only a small loop, but also two cusps. And cusps are also necessarily involved in the second ready master moves. And I draw here not all possible cases of the moves, but other cases are obtained by symmetries, which are, I think, obvious. So, with this theorem, the question becomes just combinatorial. We have if we have two front projections, we may ask whether or not they can be obtained from one another by a sequence of these moves. And of course, it is natural to ask in these settings, can this question be decided by some algorithm? And this is what we have done. The answer to this question is yes. We have a complete algorithm that can decide whether two front projections define equivalently Legendrian knots. And such algorithms in three-dimensional topology are typically very complicated. Of course, this is just a theoretical solution. we have some algorithm, but it requires, in general, it would require huge time to implement. But what one can say in practice, can one apply this procedure in some cases? And here, the answer is that sometimes you can run the procedure not only for knots of small complexity, of course, for knots like trefoil, probably with small number of cusps, probably it would be not, it could be implemented because it is very, very simple knot. But in general, the algorithm is very complicated. It requires huge exhaustive searches, but sometimes in very specific situations, you can apply our method even for knots of very high complexity. So here are a couple of examples. This is an example of, it is not the trefoil, it is a knot which has at least 10 crossings in a planar projection. And we can show by using our method that all these six Legendrian knots different, and it was not known before our work. So it is this particular case is a new knowledge. And here is a more complicated example. There are more than 250 crossings in each of these pictures. So these are topologically equivalent Legendrian knots, which are not equivalent as Legendrian knots. And I will tell you at the end of my talk why this particular example was produced. So sometimes in practice, our method does work even in very complicated cases. So let me also recall some classical things about Legendrian knots. There are two invariants which are known long ago. One is called Thurston-Beneke number, and another is called rotation number or Maslow index. These are two invariants defined in terms of some linking numbers. If you have a front projection, then Thurston-Beneke number just counts the rise of the knot less one half of the number of cusps. And rotation number defines as the difference between number of cusps oriented down and number of cusps oriented up, meaning that we have rotation number is defined only for knots oriented knots, and Thurston Benincke number actually, well, it is defined for oriented links, but for knots it doesn't depend on the orientation. So sometimes you may speak about non-oriented knots and still they have well-defined Thurston Benincke number. There are operations that definitely change both invariants. They are called stabilizations and destabilizations. You just take an arc of your front projection and introduce two new cusps. In this case, Thurston Benincke number is shifted by minus one. It goes down, so it likes to be negative. Thurston Benincke number is easy to make it negative. Just add many cusps. And rotation number goes up or down by one depending on the orientation. So it means that you always get a different Legendre not different from the original one. And it is observation by Fuchs and Tabachnikov that such operations can relate any two Legendre knots which are topologically equivalent. So by using stabilizations and destabilization, you can walk from one Legendre knot to another, if and only if they are topologically equivalent. And of course, it is natural to ask whether it suffices to know these two classical invariants, Thurston Benincke number and rotation number. And Eliasberg and Fraser proved that in the case of topologically trivial knots, this is enough. So these are complete invariants for topologically trivial knots. And moreover, it is easy to specify which pairs of numbers can be Thurston Benincke and rotation numbers of a topologically trivial knot, simply because there is one knot with maximal Thurston Benincke number equals to minus one. And then all the other Legendrian types of trivial knots are obtained by stabilizations. So the only question is how many stabilizations you make, how many positive and how many negative stabilizations you make, and that's it. So you need just two numbers. For non-trivial knots, it is not true. And the first example was demonstrated by Yuri Chikanov in 1997. The knots are shown here. They have topological type 5-2. And he used the so-called differential graded algebras, and similar invariants were invited independently at about the same time by Yakov Eliasberg. So these were the first strong invariants which allowed to distinguish many other examples of Legendre knots. And some more algebraic invariants were introduced by these people, in particular using the Hegar-Floyd homology by Osvath and Saba. Algebraic invariants distinguish many other pairs of Legendre knots having the same classical invariants, but still they are not enough. These invariants are not enough to distinguish even knots with Legendre knots with moderate complexity, like 10 crossings. There is another approach to study Legendre knots that uses so-called Giroux convex surfaces. The name convex surface is not very intuitively connected to what they actually are. So this name actually does not fit very much. It comes from convex surfaces in symplectic topology. So it was related somehow, but in contact topology, it does not suggest you what the definition actually is. But but people call it like that. They were introduced by Giroux, and this is a very powerful instrument to study Legendre knots, but it is a thing that there is no universal way to use it. When you have an algebraic invariant, it's very simple. You have a definition and you just compute. Giroux convex surfaces are some topological tool that you can apply every time in some there is no algorithm how to use them. There are some, they provide you with some invariants, but they don't provide you with an algorithm to compute this invariant. So it is an instrument that is not so easy to use as algebraic invariants. And so what we did, we used some combinatorial method to work with Giroux convex surfaces and with Legendre knots. The method is generally called rectangular diagrams. Using this, let me give you the definitions that we use here. Rectangular diagram is a set of points on the plane, such that finite set of points such that every horizontal or vertical line contains either none of them or exactly two. So if you take any point in my set and draw a vertical and horizontal line, there will be exactly one more point at each of these lines. And of course, I call these points vertices of the diagram. And such a diagram represents a knot in a, yeah, by the way, if you know the Higgard-Fleur homology theory, then you should know the thing like grid diagram, and it is actually almost the same thing. We have a little bit different point of view on this, and there is another reason why I use this terminology. But if you know what a grid diagram is, then actually it is. In this talk, there will be no essential distinction between grid diagrams and rectangular diagrams. Okay, so in order to obtain a picture of a link represented or not represented by a rectangular diagram, we connect vertices by edges. First, we draw vertical edges, which will be over crossings and at every intersection. And then we draw horizontal ones, which are under crossings. Underpassing every crossing. So, and we get a conventional picture of a link. There is a theorem which was in a slightly different form, using slightly different set of definitions. It is due to Peter Cromwell and also slightly different set of proofs, actually, but this is an exercise to show that this set of moves are equivalent. So there are elementary moves which are like Rademacher moves for planar diagrams, elementary moves of rectangular diagrams. First, these moves are cyclic shifts, exchange moves, and stabilizations and destabilizations. By cyclic move, I mean the following. Suppose that all vertices of my diagram are in this gray box, except two vertices which are shown on the left. Then we can move them, these vertices, to the right, and it is not hard to see that we get an equivalent rectangular diagram that represents an equivalent link. Similarly, we can move vertices from the top to the bottom, from the bottom to the top. I'm sorry, my mouse stopped responding, and I'm trying to fix it. Okay, another type of moves are exchange moves. if you have two parallel edges, such that in between the lines containing these edges, there are no other vertices, then we can exchange these edges by moving first pair of vertices, by exchanging the lines containing these edges. And this is done only if the projections of the edges to the straight line, to a straight line parallel to them, produces two pairs of vertices which do not interleave. So they are either nested like in this picture, or they are apart, they are separated by some perpendicular line as in this picture. And similarly, you can exchange vertical edges. So this is, I think that by now it is pretty well known. These operations should be pretty well known. And there are also stabilizations and destabilizations. And the feature of these operations is that they change the number of vertices of the diagram. Cyclic shifts may be, sometimes I consider cyclic shifts as not being an operation at all, because I view a rectangular diagram as a set of points on a two-dimensional torus. So in cyclic shift is just, cyclic shift means just means that I cut the torus in a different way to get a square. And exchange moves do not change the number of vertices. It is important. And this means that I always can perform an exhaustive search of all diagrams obtained from the given one by exchange moves, and this search would be finite. But stabilizations and destabilization, of course, we need some operation that produces infinite number of diagrams. And stabilizations and destabilizations are exactly those who do so. And the meaning of stabilization is a replacement of a single vertex by three vertices, so that all four form the set of vertices of a small square. At every vertex, I can perform stabilization in four different ways shown here. And it will be important for me to distinguish between two types of stabilizations and destabilizations. So if the square is attached on the left and below the vertex, or up and to the right, then it is type one. And the other ways, in the other two cases, it is type two. Okay. If the diagram is oriented, if I consider a rectangular diagram together with orientation, and I'm not telling you details how to define an orientation, but it exactly corresponds to the standard notion of orientation of a link. So the rectangular diagrams can be oriented in a similar manner. So in the case of oriented links, one can distinguish four subtypes of stabilizations and destabilizations. And the subtypes are defined as follows. If you see this, look, a stabilization creates two short edges, one vertical and one horizontal. And the arrow here specifies the orientation of the short edge. This is the rule that we use to in our notation. So another point, which is typically not taken into account, is that how we consider the concept of a move, like Rademeister move or elementary move, and so on. The point is that we always define moves as small changes of the diagram. And the small change of the diagram gives you an opportunity to define, to associate a well-defined homeomorphism from that takes one node to another, which is defined up to isotopy, which fixes which fixes the knot. So each move is not just a pair of diagrams, as one typically thinks of moves, like with the master moves. Each move actually is a morphism in a category. So, this category is of course a group point. Each move can be inverted. And if you look at the group of the morphisms of a fixed knot to itself, then this group is called the symmetry group. In this talk, I mean by symmetry group, slightly smaller group than one typically does. Typically one considers all possible symmetries, including those that flip the orientation of the knot or the orientation of the three-dimensional sphere. I consider only only orientation preserving symmetries. So my symmetry group that I will talk about consists only of such elements that preserve all orientations of the knot and of the three sphere. Actually, in this context, it is important to switch to the three sphere. Not a three space. The theory of Legendrian knots is the same in a three sphere and in a three space. But in this context, it is important to switch to the three sphere. So, okay. And the Rademeister theorem and the theorem about elementary moves should actually be formulated in a slightly stronger way. The way is that whenever two diagrams define equivalent knots, then any morphism from one knot to another can be represented by Rademeister moves or elementary moves in terms of in the case of rectangular diagrams. So not only they are related somehow, but any specific morphism can be decomposed into moves, elementary moves or Rademeister moves, depending on the context. So now, what is the relation of? There is a very nice relation between rectangular diagrams and Legendrian knots, and it was my attention was drawn to this question by Bill Minesco almost 20 years ago, in 2003. And once you are told that these two things are related, it is not hard to understand what exactly the relation is. The relation is as follows. With every rectangular diagram, one associates two Legendrian knots. And first, I denote them L plus and L minus. L plus is obtained as follows. We take the rectangular diagram, rotated counterclockwise some angle between 0 and 90 degrees, and then smooth out. And we get a front projection of some Legendrian knot, which we denote L plus. Similarly, we can consider not the standard contact structure, but the mirror image of this contact structure, which is defined by the differential form x dy minus dz, dz. And in this case, even we can similarly rotate the diagram clockwise. And what we get will be the front projection, but at every crossing, the rule will be the opposite to the original one. So this will be the front projection of a Legendrian knot with respect to the mirror image of the standard contact structure. So with every rectangular diagram, we associate two Legendrian knots, but one of them is Legendrian with respect to the standard contact structure, and the other is Legendrian with respect to the mirror image of the standard contact structure. And the nice thing is that these two guys, L plus and L minus, are kind of independent of each other. Well, of course, they have the same topological type. But so let me explain what I mean. First of all, cyclic shifts and exchange moves do not change the equivalence class of, so I denote, I think I denote by plus and minus equivalence classes. So not concrete nodes, but equivalence classes. L plus and L minus are not changed by exchange moves and cyclic shifts. They are changed by stabilizations and destabilizations, but stabilizations of type one change L minus and preserve L plus. And stabilizations and destabilizations of type two change L plus and preserve L minus. So we can change them independently by stabilizations. And when we perform a stabilization of type one or type two, one of these Legendre knots is preserved. I mean, equivalence class of Legendre knots is preserved, and the other is stabilized. So these operations translate to stabilizations and destabilizations of the corresponding Legendre knots. One can show that if two rectangular diagrams represent the same Legendre knot L plus or respectively L minus, then these two diagrams are related by sequence of elementary moves, including only type one stabilizations. So if we just forbid stabilizations of type one or type two, just choose one of the types of stabilizations and destabilizations, we get a theory of Legendre knots. We get another combinatorial way to represent Legendre knots and another analog of Rademeister theorem for Legendre knots. So yeah, this is summarized here. Legendre knots may be viewed as rectangular diagrams up to exchange moves, cyclic shifts, and type one stabilizations and destabilizations, or type two stabilizations and destabilizations. Choose whichever you like. So, and what we shown with Maxim Prasolov in 2013 is that there is a kind of independence between L plus and L minus. But at that time, we showed it in the following weak form. We showed that if L plus, for instance, admits a destabilization, then we can perform this destabilization by a sequence on the level of rectangular diagrams, by sequence of exchange moves, and then a destabilization of the rectangular diagram. So we can do it without distorting L minus. We can change L plus in both ways. If it admits stabilizations, of course it is, if you want to stabilize it, of course it is trivial. We just perform a stabilization of the corresponding rectangular diagram. But if it admits destabilizations, it is completely not obvious that you can apply, you can simplify the rectangular diagram by sequence of moves without need of any other stabilization. So this is what we proved in 2013. And one of the consequences was so-called Jones conjecture, which I'm not going to explain here. But now we can prove it in a stronger form. Namely, we now prove the following. Suppose we have two rectangular diagrams which are related by exchange moves, and one of them admits a type one destabilization and another admits a type two destabilization. Then we can close up this diagram as follows. So we can perform some exchange move on this diagram to obtain a diagram which is simplified by a type two destabilization. And this diagram can be transformed by exchange moves to a diagram that admits a type one destabilization. And what we get in these two different ways are rectangular diagrams, which are also related by exchange moves. So this is kind of a partial diamond lemma. If you look at rectangular diagrams up to exchange moves do not change the Legendrian types. Yes, we used to think of exchange classes, rectangle diagrams up to exchange moves. So if you have an exchange class which admits simplification of type one and simplification of type two, then there is a partial diamond lemma for that. And another point that we proved with Maxim Brasilov is that suppose we have two rectangular diagrams such that both Legendrian knots for the first diagram associated with the first diagram are equivalent to the respective Legendrian knots associated with the second diagram. But of course, this is true if the diagram are related by exchange moves, but suppose they are not. So there is no sequence of exchange moves between these diagrams. So we can go from one diagram to the other one by using exchange moves and type one stabilizations and destabilizations and go the other way by using exchange moves and type two stabilizations and destabilizations. And what we claim in this situation, then the round trip, if we consider this sequence, if we concatenate these sequences of moves, so we start from the diagram R1 and arrive at the same diagram R1, then we get a sequence of moves representing a non-trivial element of the symmetry group. So what it gives us? There is another lemma which has nothing to do with Legendrian stuff. And actually this is small upgrade of the algorithm for comparing Hacking manifolds. We just used the book of Sergei Matveev, where he describes the full algorithm for comparing Hacking manifold, and in particular, a full algorithm for comparing knots, ordinary knots, up to topological equivalence. So this algorithm can be upgraded to get the following. Given a knot, one can compute a finite set of generators for the symmetry group. It does not mean we can compute the symmetry group in any sense. So we don't pretend to know what the symmetry group is, but we can produce a set of generators. So that we know that this set of elements generate the whole group, the entire group, but we don't know any relations and et cetera. So another point is that suppose we know some generators of the symmetry group in terms of rectangular diagrams, in terms of elementary moves of rectangular diagrams. And we count the number of stabilizations of each subtype in each of these sequences of moves. Then the claim is that now any element of the symmetry group can be realized by a sequence of elementary moves using that number of stabilizations and destabilizations. So we know when we compute generators, the generating set for the symmetry group, we know how to produce, we know that in order to produce any other element of the symmetry group, we don't need, we know how many stabilizations and destabilizations we need at most. So now how the algorithm works. Suppose we have two rectangular diagrams and we want to decide whether or not they define equivalent Legendrian knots with respect to the standard contact structure, L plus. Yes, what we do is first we find a rectangular diagram L1 prime such that L plus associated with L1 prime is the same as that of that associated with R1. And L minus is the same as that associated with R2. Why it exists? It exists due to our result in 2013, And since it exists, it can be found by an exhaustive search. It is, we just look at all possible ways to go from R1 by elementary moves, yeah, produce all possible sequences. And at some moment we will find such a sequence that first consists of exchange moves and type one stabilizations and destabilizations, and then only type two stabilizations and destabilization occur. And this is in the middle, we will get the R1 prime, which is needed here. Then we produce the generated set for the symmetry group, expressed in terms of elementary moves. And count how many stabilizations and destabilizations of each subtype we needed for representing any of these generators. Then we stabilize the diagrams R1 prime and R2 as many times as we found necessary, namely as many times as was enough to produce the generators. Okay, and we get two diagrams. And the claim now is that if L plus of R1 was equal to L plus of R2, then now R3, and it is now also true for R3 and R4. And so there is a misprint here because we need, we apply this type is wrong. Oops, sorry. This type is wrong. It should be type one with arrow directed the other way. I'm sorry. Here is a typo. So and now we arrive to diagrams which, if we have this equality L plus of R1 equal to L plus of R2, if and only if these two diagrams are related by exchange moves. So why does this work in such complicated cases, for instance? Yes. So what is interesting about this example? It is interesting that these are two components of a link. They are separated now, but originally they were two components of the boundary of an annulus, of a tangled annulus, which is tangent to the standard contact structure on the entire boundary. And the point here that these two knots are not Legendre equivalent, which is the first example, the first known example of such phenomenon. If you try simpler examples, we tried many before we found this one. If you tried simple examples of annuli, which are tangent to the standard contact structure along the whole boundary, then you will, in most cases, you will get equivalent Legendrian knots. And it was an open question. And even there is some PhD thesis uploaded to the archive, not published, but uploaded to archive, where it is claimed that whenever you have such, well, it is there is a more general claim, but one of immediate consequences is that if you have an annulus tangent to the standard contact structure on the entire boundary, then the two components of the boundary are equivalent as Legendre knots. And we show that it is not true. We produced an annulus which does not have this property. And how to make the algorithm work in this case? The best news here is that the symmetry group is trivial. And so let me just mention how the example was produced, the example of the annulus. The point is that we use, in our theory, we use the concept of a rectangular diagram of a surface. And in the particular case of an annulus that we needed. The combinatorial object is as follows. It is just a sequence of rectangles in a two-dimensional torus such that they form kind of a chain. Such that the top right vertex of any rectangle is the bottom left vertex of the next rectangle. And rectangles must be either disjoint, or they have a common vertex, or they intersect like this. And then the set of vertices of these rectangles, which are not shared between two of them, form a link. And this family, this set of rectangles represents in certain way, which I don't have time to explain, it represents an annulus. And the vertices which are not shared represent the rectangular diagram of the two component link, which bounds this annulus. Okay, so this is an example. You see, this is rectangle 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, 5, 6, and so on. So this is a simple example in which the boundary components will be equivalent as Legendre and Lix. So, but in this case, yeah, in this simple case, we will have equivalent Legendre knots. And you will have such equivalence in many simple situations. So you really need to do something to create some very complicated example in order to get in equivalence. So, and here is a few slides showing how we produced the annulus. Yes, red vertices are one component and the blue vertices are the other component. So these are two components together. And from the construction, we know in advance that the Legendre knots associated with two diagrams with respect to the mirror image of the standard contact structure will be equivalent. This is for some reason, this is for free. So here is some sort of explanation. And why it is possible to apply our method in this case, this is due to the fact that the symmetry group of this knot, of this topological type knot, is trivial. And in order to show this, we analyze the Alexander polynomial. It is, well, first we need to show that this knot is hyperbolic. It is, it can be made more or less by hand, almost by hand. And in order to show that it does not admit any symmetries, rotational symmetries, it suffices to analyze the Alexandre polynomial. And fortunately, the Alexandre polynomial of this knot is not very, does not have very large degrees. So it is, there are known facts about Alexandre polynomial of knot admitting symmetries. So it is, we had to check some properties of this polynomial. And this is what we did with Vladimir Shastin. So, and that's it. Thank you very much.
So thank you for the nice, interesting talk. Are there any questions, please? So if there are no questions, then let us thank the speaker again.
Thank you.